Hey there everybody, this is Ed from High Point coming at you today with a video on ZWO's ASIAIR Mini. Today we're going to be taking a look at what's new with the ASIAIR Mini and discuss a little bit about who it might be for. So without further ado, let's get into it. Now, while today's video is going to be a little bit on the shorter side, it is still going to be broken up into chapters, so if there is a section that you're particularly interested in, check the timeline down below for a timestamp to that. Additionally, before we jump into it here, I do want to just repeat, you know, that YouTube mantra. If you're not subscribed already, we would appreciate if you'd consider subscribing for more astronomy and astronomy product-based content. If you find today's video helpful, if you could give it a like, it really helps us out. And then, if at the end of the video you have any thoughts on our assessment of the ASIAIR Mini, or maybe the ASIAIR system in general, please leave them down in the comment section down below. Now briefly, just in case you're not already familiar with the ASIAIR system, what it is a line of mini PCs like the ASIAIR Mini, or this older ASIAIR Pro that's since been discontinued, that have a number of additions to them to make them more suitable for astronomy in general. Now what I mean by that is you'll see that the ASIAIR has 12 volt DC out ports so that you can run your cooled cameras or any other kit that runs off 12 volt DC power. It comes with its own operating system installed on there that utilizes Wi-Fi to generate its own hotspot that you then connect to with your smartphone or tablet to then remotely control your astrophotography rig. So, you know, your mount, your camera, your guide camera, filter wheel, electronic focuser, that kind of stuff. It's all dedicated to controlling that. Okay, so now that we're all caught up on what the ASIAIR system is, what does the ASIAIR Mini in particular bring to the table? Well, unlike prior releases of the ASIAIR that were more of a generational step forward, whereas the older model was discontinued and the newer model brought a lot of changes, like for example the ASIAIR Pro that brought this red anodized aluminum case and design that's kind of become emblematic of the ASIAIR lineup moving forward, and where the Plus improved upon the performance and connectivity of the ASIAIR Pro, the ASIAIR Mini is less of a generational step forward and more of an expansion of the existing ASIAIR Plus line. What I mean by that is that instead of improving upon the performance or the functionality of the ASIAIR Plus, or maintaining the exact same performance and functionality and shrinking it down into a smaller package, the ASIAIR Mini more targets a lower price point and form factor, and consequently loses maybe a little bit of the functionality of the ASIAIR Plus. Now, the two things that it does improve over the ASIAIR Plus, I have already touched on or alluded to already. It does come in at a lower price point than the ASIAIR Plus, and then, most importantly, it's the ASIAIR Mini, it's smaller. But just how much smaller? It is, according to ZWO, 21% lighter than the ASIAIR Plus and 42% smaller. So it's a good deal more compact and lightweight than the ASIAIR Plus. So to get a lighter, smaller, cheaper device, what exactly did ZWO have to adjust on the ASIAIR Mini? Well, starting off on some of the more minor points, the ASIAIR Mini does not have a micro SD card slot like the ASIAIR Plus does for offloading files from the device. It also does not have a physical on-off button to power cycle the device. So if you are going to leave this connected to your setup, you are gonna either have to turn off the power supply or disconnect it completely. There's no way to just turn it off. Though there is a physical hard reset button. Additionally, you're not able to monitor the output voltage from the four 12 volt DC out ports on the device. And then lastly, there is no wired LAN port on the ASIAIR Mini. Even with the extended range that the antenna on the ASIAIR Mini and Plus net you, if that's still not enough, you're not going to have the option to hardwire the ASIAIR Mini into your network, whereas you can do that with the ASIAIR Plus. Now, some of the more major adjustments that ZWO had to make on the ASIAIR Mini, the first one is no USB 3.0 ports on the device whatsoever. All four of these are USB 2.0. So if you have one of their pro cameras or just one of their cameras that you want to make sure you have that full USB 3.0 connection, you're not going to get that here. You are going to be bottlenecked to USB 2.0. Now, dovetailing on that point, the final main difference between the ASIAIR Mini and the ASIAIR Plus is that the ASIAIR Mini is limited in the cameras that it can do live stacking with. In particular, cameras that are over 26 megapixels cannot use the live stack mode on the ASIAIR Mini. So with the capabilities of the ASIAIR Mini, that kind of brings us to the heart of today's video. Namely, who is the ASIAIR Mini for? To answer that, we just need to circle back to what does the ASIAIR Mini do well? It provides a good amount of power in a small, compact form factor. Accordingly, this is going to be best paired with something like an ultra-portable setup that you're trying to build out. So, say for instance, you've got a Skywatcher GTI and you're going to be putting a DSLR on there to do some wide field astrophotography, but maybe you want to add like a separate guide scope or just a little bit more power and capability on top of just what that go-to mount offers. Well then, the ASIAIR Mini is probably going to be a good option for you. Outside of that use case, however, it's hard to argue that the ASIAIR Mini is going to be best suited for most other applications, be that beginners or people just looking to either move away from a laptop or either who have a dedicated astrophotography rig and are looking to expand their setup. And what I mean by that is that while the ASIAIR is a great system to add, you know, remote capabilities to a setup that you already have, one that you're trying to add, or just getting started with it, you know, getting started in the hobby, it does limit you to ZWO cameras, focusers, filter wheels, and the software that's included in the ASIAIR's, you know, operating system, their imaging, guiding, and planetarium software. Now, that's not to knock the system. A lot of people really like the, you know, software that comes with the ASIAIR and is built in there. It's just to say that switching to an option that limits that already sort of limited system, you know, with the concessions that the ASIAIR Mini makes to hit that lower price point and that smaller form factor, it's just a hard point to argue that that's going to be best for most people. To cut a long-winded explanation there short, essentially, when you're working with a system that is inherently a little bit limited, for most people, picking the system that allows you to move the most within that limited system is going to be the better option. Okay, everybody, that's going to end off today's video. I hope you've enjoyed this look at the ASIAIR Mini and our thoughts on who it might be for. Again, it's certainly going to serve some people really well, but for most, you're probably better off with the Plus, especially if you're going for maybe a more professional setup or look. So what did you think of the ASIAIR Mini? Do you agree with our assessment of it? What are some things you might like to see to the ASIAIR lineup? Let us know in the comments section down below. We really appreciate your feedback. Again, I hope you enjoyed the video, and until next time, clear skies.